Welcome to this very special conversation. Now, Pune has always been one of my favorite cities because it's so beautiful and so green. Today, we're in a city within a city. The Magarapatta city that was built purely brick mortar and on vision. And I'm with right now the man who brought that vision into the city of Pune, Mr. Satish Magar. Thank you so much for joining us. I appreciate your time. It is such a beautiful space. And I can see when we came in this morning, people who are walking and jogging and enjoying the public space in the park that you've created. I believe that something like this could have only been created with vision, because you started off before anybody had even thought about townships. From where you started off to where it is today, is this how you expected it to turn out?
No, it transformed over a period of time, you know, it evolved. Mm. I will not claim that this is what the master plan, yes, the master plan remained the same. This is what we conceived way back in mid-90s when I approached the government that we want to do a township, and we want to do a township with the farmers' participation and not a cooperative under the Companies Act.
And you got a lot of people who said, how is that even possible?
Yeah, nobody believed. But those were the times, you know, of liberalization when the government was thinking differently. So they said, let's give it a try.
And this was the then Chief Minister, Mr. Sharad Pawar.
Yeah, I proposed the township at the time of Mr. Pawar. He said that you have to go through the entire process, and by the time you know, the things started happening, then the government changed. So by the time I inaugurated, I saw four chief ministers.
To ask you which one you thought was the best.
Mr. Pawar had the vision of envisaging that such a thing can happen. Mr. Manohar Joshi had the guts of signing it, and Mr. Rane was there for a short time. I did not interact much with him. And Mr. Vilasrao Deshmukh had the generosity of coming and inaugurating.
You're a very generous reviewer, I must say. What's your review of the current government with Mr. Fadnavis?
You have to give it time. It's just 1.5 years. Yeah. Maharashtra is a very complex state. It's very developed state. There are a lot of expectations. You cannot compare it with any other states because we are far ahead. So there are a lot of issues which are there with that. I think 1.5 years has not been bad. I won't say it's bad.
So when you were drawing up the plans, obviously for permissions and things like that, for this township, it's such a massive project. Did you have a lot of people in the local level corporation who turned around and said, what is a township? Why are you doing this? This doesn't make any sense. Did you have to educate people?
Yeah, we had to, because there was no policy in place. Today we have the township policy in place. Yeah. When we approached the government in 93, we approached with a master plan. See, this is what we want to do, because these are our lands. These are part of the municipal corporation limit from 1961. If you don't do anything, then like what everything happens in the vicinity will happen. In unauthorized construction will come. We are not going to get this capital again. We don't want to waste that capital. So why don't we do an integrated township with all the facilities, you know, which are there in the MRTP Act? We just implement the act in totality. Give us the permission. So they did take time. 7 years was the total time frame which they took to do it. But they did it.
The current township policy offers, you know, a higher FSI for anyone looking at creating a township. From the fact that you did this township, you didn't have a policy. Yeah. Now you're doing Nanded, and I understand there's a third project in the pipeline that will be announced soon. Have things gotten simpler, better in terms of
approvals?
Yeah,
it has evolved, because when we did Magarapatta City, there was no policy. So we had to go through the entire process of de-zoning, you know, getting the approvals from the municipal corporation, going through the general body. At that point of time, we also insisted to the government that you please notify it in the gazette with all the reservations. You know, I am a developer, you know, I may want to change something afterwards, but don't let me do it. Notify the master plan. So the master plan was notified. This was probably the first time like any other DP it was notified. You know, it was a part like a DP, it was like a DP. And then we did a presentation to Mr. Vilasrao Deshmukh in that, I think 2002 was the time when the State Infrastructure Summit was held. They took it forward from there. 2005, the first policy came. There were shortfalls in the first policy. There was a process of doing it in the second time. It didn't happen in the second time when Mr. Prithviraj Chauhan was there. You know, elections came, some issues happened, and then again it started coming up now. Now I think a lot of those practical problems which have been faced have been overcome. So additional FSI is required, because if you don't incentivize these townships, see, the entire infrastructure is done by the developer.
Right.
In the other cases, you don't have to do this infrastructure. It's done by the government. So to, you know, recover this cost, to provide good facilities, I think this policy was good, which is coming now.
We get a lot of complaints, and we hear about local level corruption over things like OCs, over things like permissions in Pune. What are you facing?
my personal experience, there are two folds in this. Number one is, this is like a farmers' participation project. India, you know, is a very highly politicized country, and when the farmers' involvement comes, things happen more straighter.
Okay. That is nobody wants. Nobody wants to upset the farmers.
Nobody wants to upset the farmers. That is one thing. Second thing, what I have realized through experience over the years, that if you are not asking for discretion, and if you have everything within the format, and not asking for an additional favor, I think things happen much smoother.
Well, your format is very interesting. Your farmers who started off with you were the investors. So technically, you are the only one in the country who's managed land pooling, which a lot of governments have not managed to do. I mean, the Maharashtra government is trying to do it with the Naina region. They haven't successfully managed to do it.
They will do it.
We know the Delhi government's land pooling policy has been waiting for years. Why is it that you've managed to pull off something that the governments have not? Nobody else has managed to do it in the country.
I think it was luck. Transparency, yes. See, what happens is that we had, you know, a comparison when we started thinking of this in the 90s. Because I own land, I belong to this place.
Yes.
My ancestral roots are here. So we saw what was happening to the farmers in the urban area, urban farmers. We are urban farmers.
Yes.
You know, if you would ask me to sell this land and go 60 kilometers away and do agriculture, not possible. Because we were city bred. You know, we had all the facilities and we enjoyed all the facilities of cities at that point of time. So, we saw what happened with people. This was a capital which we have inherited for generations. So, we came out with an idea that this is our capital, this is our raw material. You know, make it into a fine product and get more. So, at that point
of time...
I mean,
one of the options was, of course, to sell it to a developer. But you kept the farmers.
But then that money would have come. What would have done with that money? We'd have all joined politics. We would have all spent the money in all non-productive things. And because we did not know to do business. That is the problem with the Indian farmers. We only know to farm against all the you know, natural calamities, but we don't have that business knowledge. We did not have. Things are changing now. We don't have that business knowledge, so that money would have been wasted.
I mean, you said it was luck. Was it more your farming background or your political background that helped you pull it off?
I
you have
both.
A dual background. Yeah, there's an agricultural and political.
Not a dual. I have a triple background. I'm a developer also. Farming background, yes, it helped. My family's political background helped because we have been here for many years. We are not in politics any longer, but my uncle was a member of parliament when he expired. So, you know, there was a connect with the local people. We all lived together as a community right from the beginning, for years together. And so when the decision came as to whether we do proper development or we do improper development, we sell the land or we become developers, I think that background helped. Because I had that connect. I was doing agriculture here, so I had the connect with the people. So that helped.
Of course, you know, your farmer investors had to wait about 8 to 10 years to actually start to see construction come up. How did you manage expectations?
It's very easy to sell dreams to a farmer.
It's very easy to sell dreams to a farmer.
Yeah, so we kept on selling a dream. We made a master plan and we made a model out of it in those days. And we said that this is how it will look. And this is what we can do.
And for 8 years, you pointed at a master plan.
Yeah, and I mean, agriculture was still going on. There was nothing to lose. But the only issue was to hold them together so that they don't sell.
How did you do that?
By telling them that we have an opportunity, next year it will get sanctioned, next year it will get sanctioned. We were meeting every month. Practically every month we met. We spoke about, you know, the process which is going on. We also spoke to people about, you know, how they can become entrepreneurs. Because most of these people are not educated to do construction lines. So, you know, we tied up with institutes like NICMAR. We got them trained on other sites. We did a lot of backward integration. We had a lot of, you know, discussions with the younger generation to how they can become entrepreneurs. With our backward integration, what else we can do? You know, we did the calculation that so much of sand will require, so much of metal will require, so much of roads will have to be developed. So this is an opportunity for us. And so that whole training process, getting people involved in that, being a part of the entire development process, I think kept them together.
Of course, the first set of farmers of Magarpeta city are 51% stake owners in the new project, which is the Nandet city.
Yeah.
And I understand that will keep rolling over like that.
Keep on rolling.
So that just, I mean, if you look at them as investors purely, it's just faith that the investors are showing in you, saying that, okay, we'll reinvest our profits in your next project. How much time of yours in a week or a month goes in spending time with these investors and these farmers, in communicating with them, in managing their expectations, in sort of keeping that group together?
Yeah, now we have got that process in place. So it's become a more of a professional process where there are people who you know, handle them, they look after them.
You don't have to do it personally anymore.
But I personally meet, for Nandyal City, I meet them on every Thursdays. On Magarpeta City, they don't need to meet me, but they can meet me on a Sunday morning. The third project, I have not started meeting them frequently, but I will start meeting them frequently now, because now the process has started getting into place. Because they have a lot of small issues, you know, they have family problems, they have a partition problem. They need someone to handhold, you know, you cannot have a very professional relationship, you have to have an emotional connect. Though we have people handling them, I think in Magarpeta I had to spend more time. Now my people are also more tuned to, you know, work with these people, so it's become more easier now.
Tell me about the third project.
It's again a township, it's on the eastern part of the Pune. We have got all the permissions, you know, we got the locational clearance now from the government. So it's going to go through the environmental process to try and get the environmental clearances off. So it's again the same format, 51% is held by the Magarpeta group.
How long do you think it's going to take to get the environment clearance for a 600 acre township, if I'm not mistaken?
Yeah, it's a 500 odd acre township, but I don't think it should take time, because what we tell people that you come here. Because when we started Magarpeta, it was basically to protect the interest in our land. Then we decided that if you're doing that, why don't you plan an integrated township? Right. When we started executing it, the first set of people came to stay in 2002, and my work went on till 2012. And you can imagine a construction site next to your house. So how to make people feel comfortable? We started managing it. So we manage garbage, we manage affluent, we manage water. So we tell people, even the environmental people, you come and see here, we manage everything. So we do the same thing there. Let's hope they listen to it.
Well, I also want to ask you about the NGT. We'll be talking about environment clearances. One of the problems that I know, and as a representative of Kridai nationally, one of the problems that developers are facing across the country is after the environment clearances come in, there's an order from the NGT that sort of makes everybody go back to the drawing board. Bangalore is facing an issue right now, but there have been problems
in... I personally feel that, environmental clearance for a residential project is okay. But you are doing an environmental project where there is a non-affluent industry. I don't know what sense it makes. You have the restrictions which they are now planning to have it on the local body to check. And they were doing it before. I mean, once you give them the environmental clearance, once they construct, what is the follow-up mechanism on that? What does we look into it? But it has become more of a fashion to hammer developers. And then you have done this mistake, you have done that mistake. If you do a slum, it's okay. You do illegal work, it's okay, but you want to do regularized work in this country, I think you need to be tested.
You know, that's the other thing. The fact that if we look at all of the various stakeholders at this point, whether it's customers, whether it's some parties, some portions of government, or maybe the people who are framing the rules for RERA, the courts at this point, the NGT, all looking at developers like the big bad wolf.
I don't know why.
Giving very little, benefit of doubt to developers.
I don't know why. See, I work in the Chamber of Commerce, so I always tell my friends there that you do one factory and three generations, run after it. So you only put in all the hard work and one time, and then you put the hard work to manage it. Here for us, every project is a factory. And we are creating wealth. We are creating that emotional component of a person which he requires is a home. There are more expectations than buying a car and buying a house. So a person, when he buys a house, is with a magnifying glass, they keep on checking every small thing. Yes, because there's a 15-year, 17-year connect. And it's an emotional place, to spend all their time in that, whether it is sorrow, whether it is joy, there's a wedding, there's a child born. It's all in that home, so there's an attachment to it. So they expect the best out of it. And 15, 16 years, they're repaying for it. We have consumer forums. We have our own redressal in Kridai. People do come to us with complaints. And people have changed. Here there are 7,500 apartment holders living together in harmony. This is happening across the country. But like everywhere else, there is one segment, one element. See, anyone becomes a developer. Anyone is a builder. Whoever builds a house is a builder. So if you do an illegal construction also, you do an illegal building, you are also a builder. So if he does a mistake, the whole builders are ranked. So that is not correct.
Sadish, thank you for talking to us. I remember in one of the interviews that you had given to a newspaper, you said that when you started off with this project, you were very stingy with how you spent your money. You kept the budgets really tight, and that's how you made it work.
Yeah, because such a large project in 2000, we launched Magarpeta City on 3rd of December 1999. And that time, I don't think any of the financial institutions were ready to put their money onto us.
Right.
So
HDFC invested.
Yes, Mr. Parekh was convinced. But when I went to him with a 100 crore proposal, he said, no, you can't take so much of money. How will you service the interest? So you start small, grow big. So he started with 2 crores. And he really taught us, actually, I should give him all the credit, how to be very aggressive in marketing, how to be very, stingy on spending your money, how not to be extravagant. And because of that, I think a lot of things happened. And then it became a culture. It became a part of our life, that we might.
There's a learning there, because right now we're at a phase in the market where a lot of developers are sort of over-leveraged, financially stretched, launched too many projects, not enough finances to back all of it, not enough money to service the debt. Is there a learning that perhaps financial prudence and being stingy on the budgets is something that everybody should sort of pick up in this market?
Yeah, when we launched in 2000, I think that was the worst time in real estate. The things were extremely bad. So we could survive that. Again, after the Lehman crisis, there was a problem here. That time we launched the second project, which was much larger than this. So again, because of that being very stingy on spending money, I think helped us. And I think if you can put that money back, and that is what RERA is saying, and that is what everyone is expected to do now, if you put majority of money back into the same construction, I think you can do it on time.
I was going to bring that up. The fact that we are in a bad phase of the market, but this is not the only one you've seen. You've seen several cycles of the real estate market in India. Do you believe that the way RERA has been drafted so far, and the Maharashtra government is working on its rules for the, I understand, next 15 days or so, we'll see something. Is it too harsh? Is it in the right spirit? Should there be something that's re-looked at?
Yes, it has to be, because there are two aspects which have not been very strongly covered in Dubai. Number one is the sanctioning authority. You put me under all the scrutiny, you put me with all the handcuffs around, you tie my legs, you tie my hands, and you ask me to swim. And then you have the authorities who can take their own time. Why they should also be under the purview? Because if everyone has a time-bound process, I think it works. Today, all the municipal corporations, the government, under the ease of doing business, under various factors, is looking at doing things very, efficiently. But I still feel that if they would have also come under that scare of RERA, things would have been much better. And also the customers, I mean, they are our customers, they are our God, customers, you are God. But even they should pay on time, you can't...
RERA talks about sort of equalizing the interest rates on both sides. So if the customer delays or the developer
delays. But see, what happens is, if the customer delays, it is more hitting than the developer delaying it, because you have to pay only to one person, but there's so much of development happening. But okay, fine, equal to equal, it doesn't make a difference. At least they'll be level.
So you think that just bringing approvals under the purview of the regulator is the only thing that needs to be? What about the escrow account?
They're talking about 70% escrow, and that also, there are still talks going on whether it's going to be cost of construction, whether it's going to be total cost, what you can take out. So you need to take out some money which you have spent for the land. Because you have to refurbish land, you have to get more land. So that investment process has to be much before you start project. 4 or 5 years horizon is required, where you have to put in the money and when the land can get cleared and all these things. Because land titling is still not an issue, it's a big issue with us. So getting the approvals, environment clearance you cannot get within 2 years. The approvals take time. So there's a 4-5 year horizon which is required. So that money needs to be taken out. I think if they can work on the cost of construction basis, to do much better.
So our sources are telling us that the Maharashtra government is in fact considering 70% cost of construction and not 70% of the total project.
You're much aware than me. I'm not.
So you haven't heard anything to that effect. But you're saying if it does happen, that'll be good.
Yeah, I will feel good about it.
You feel good about it. Okay.
Because we work in such stressful conditions. If that thing comes, it will be distressed a little bit.
But the other very present problem that we're facing in this market is that of delays. It's more so in the NCR region. We have a couple of cases in Pune, several cases in the MMR region as well. What advice would you give customers right now who are waiting for possession of their homes? Is it consumer court? Is it talk to the developer? Is it CREDAI's consumer grievance cell? What should they do?
I would go in a three-pronged strategy. Number one, speak to a developer first. There may be a problem. I mean, most of us are not fly-by-night operators. We also have a reputation to keep, so we can't, expect things to go wrong. If it is not solved, then you go to CREDAI. Because we have a consumer redressal cell in CREDAI. Go to CREDAI as the second phase, where if you know, the developers member of CREDAI, most of us are members of CREDAI, so we will help, CREDAI will help. And if you are still not satisfied with this problem, then the third, fourth, you go to the court, because the once the matter becomes sub judice, everyone takes their hands off. Now, CREDAI will not intervene, the builder says, let the court decide, the consumer says, you know, I will see, fight it out in the court, and it's just going to go into a spin. But if you can do it, that's why I think most of the problems could be sorted out.
You know, we now have consumers who've gotten in touch with us, who've asked for state governments to intervene. The Haryana government has begun intervening, sort of starting conversations between developers and consumers. There are also customers who are saying, if a developer has delayed a project past 5 years and not handed it over, he should not be given permissions to launch new projects. What is your reaction?
We have to go to the chronology of what actually has happened in that project. Whether it is problem of funds, whether it is problem of approvals, whether, you know, an act, a court like NGT has brought in something afterwards, whether there's a problem with the title, all these issues need to be, you know, actually checked. Because willfully, anyone who wants to do business is not going to delay. Because consumerism has come in into India. I mean, with the internet and with the social media, who's scared of the developer? Nobody's scared of the developer.
Should they be scared of developers?
No, they should not be. Why they should be scared? It's a customer-producer relationship. In fact, you know, my experience is that one happy customer, even if he gets you one customer in a year, so much of marketing expenses gets reduced. You don't have to advertise out. But one disgruntled customer can actually take you to task.
You know, I want to point out the fact that after building this massive project, and then the second one that you started, and now the third one, you have a very, very solid reputation in the market, from whether it's the investors or the customers or the farmers or whoever it is your company has dealt with. So what advice would you give other developers who are watching you as an industry leader? Because this is, I mean, the crisis of faith that developers have with customers, with investors, with other pockets of stakeholders right now is again a very massive problem.
See, what, you know, we are dealing with a lot of emotions. And when you are dealing with emotions, I think the best thing could be, and what we have learned through experience and which has been very successful in our case, is to have a communication channel open. If a landowner has any problem, let him come and speak to you. And you be available to speak to him. You know, you don't put up people in the hierarchy who have no concern, because any person who's working with you is not emotionally connected most of the time. I mean, I will not blame all the people working with you, but they are not emotionally connected. Secondly, what is the harm in speaking to your customers? What is the harm in, you know, meeting them? Because that person has put his life savings inside your project. So suppose he wants to meet you or something, what will he do at the most? He'll shout at you. He'll make a complaint. You can solve it. And if you have a forum where they can come together and meet to you, I think it does a lot of good. It does a lot of good. Touch wood, so far we have not had any problems. The only reason being is that we are accessible to the people. In fact, we have created a forum where the people can come together and they can advise us. In Magarpatta, we have something called as a citizens council. So after every flat owner, 100 flat owners, there's one representative who's on the part of the council. There are 33% seats reserved for women. So we have 100 people who meet very regularly. There are different committees. You know, there's a sports committee. There is a maintenance committee, because we have the obligation of maintaining this project.
Is the future of this industry consumer service and community building?
Yes, it is. I think that is the key. We have come to that stage now where it is no longer a seller's market, it's a buyer's market. And if you want to have a good buyer's market reputation, then consumerism and customer service is the key. Is the key. Because today in the nuclear family, with both husband and wife working, they need people to do small, small things. And if you can provide with them of this facility, even at a cost, I think they're extremely happy.
There's another view, of course, that once RERA comes in with its very stringent rules, there'll be a certain level of shakedown in the industry. A lot of peripheral fringe players will fall.
Yeah, people who do illegal work will go on.
Even the smaller ones. I've heard developers saying, I will bring down my construction by 10%, to 10% of what it is right now, so that I'm only building, my risks come down, all of it comes down. So do you expect a certain level of consolidation in this market? Are you getting calls about distressed assets that you know might be considering buying? No?
I don't think it's going to happen. Every act which comes in first, you have to give it some time to settle down.
Right.
And that is going to be the time. There are going to be court cases. There are going to be a lot of judgments, you know, right from the Supreme Court downwards everywhere. But gradually, there are regulatory acts in all other industries. Over a period of time, they have settled down. So if the government is going to be proactive and if they're going to, you know, listen to things and settle them down, I think things can happen.
What has been your experience with the Maharashtra government so far during this rules drafting process? Have they been proactive? Have they listened to representations that you have made?
See, we have got MOFA from 1963.
Yes.
Now, you can dispute on that it is not followed to the last mile, but still it was there. So we have a level of maturity because the Maharashtra Regulatory Act was already there in place. The central government put a clause there to overrun the Maharashtra Act. But there is that maturity there. We have this industry here for a very long time. So I think Maharashtra will be the leader in this because that two-way communication channel is there.
It's there. So they are listening. The government is listening to
Even CREDAI in Maharashtra, whether it is MCHAI, whether it is CREDAI Maharashtra, they are all very proactive when it comes to these stages. We all work together in this. Mumbai has their different set of problems. The rest of Maharashtra have different set of problems. But we still have common problems which we can go and lead ourselves.
Are you going to take your township format outside of Pune at any point, or are you going to stay in Pune? The rest of the country would love a township.
No, Pune is a good market. Not being a non-capital city, also, you know, there are so many growth engines which come in. There's a lot of business which is happening. A lot of IT is coming. Yesterday, the CM inaugurated the Force Motors plant, and there are so many startups which are coming to the city. So, if this city is doing good and if there's a market here, why go elsewhere? And
why would you go elsewhere?
Yeah, I would be that.
Is it because you understand both the farmers and the local?
No, because I very strongly feel that real estate is a local business. Any person who buys a flat wants to know who the promoter is. It's still not become, you know, a distant relationship industry. It's still become very emotional industry. So people want to know who's doing it. People want to see their projects. No, it is something where you're going to spend your life.
How much of a difference will the smart city plan make to Pune for the real estate market?
Yeah, a lot of, if it goes through the way they are talking, then the infrastructure would actually, you know, enhance. What we need is totally today is infrastructure planning. And if that could happen through the smart city and, you know, if the garbage problems get resolved, if the water distribution becomes even, these are the three basic things which need the city needs. In fact, even if you make a ring road and make a metro, I think our problems will be sorted out.
So what is your concern with this? You said if it comes out the way they're talking.
It has to evolve.
Okay.
You have to give it time. It's just 1 year from the announcement on the 25th, the Honorable Prime Minister is coming here to, you know, celebrate that 1 year. It should happen because there's a lot of public engagement in that. And I think that is the best thing which has happened in this movement is public engagement. And when there's public engagement and when there's citizenship participation, then people can voice their concerns. Though I would want my road in front of my house to be done first and I would want my water to be 24/7. But still, you know, that involvement is going to be much better. That is going to do a lot of good.
My last question to you is for people who expect prices of property to come down, who are waiting, even in Pune, waiting that maybe prices will come down, then I'll buy a house. Do you expect prices to come down?
How will they come down? Cost of land is still there.
Okay.
We have no control over cement.
Nobody is buying that at some point developers will have to reduce prices. We know that the prices on the negotiating table have come down 10-15%.
Yeah, because that is distress,
right?
Or he wants to liquidate. But the cement prices nobody can control. There's still that cartel is working and the steel price is rising. The government has looked at it as a milking cow. So all the taxes, all the thing, all come onto real estate. You make an ATIB scheme, but the tax department doesn't let you go scot-free. So with all these taxes and all, it is going to be loaded somewhere. I mean, people don't understand that today this has become like an industry. We are all working on a 5%, 7% margin. Because the cost of funds has to be most expensive here. The cost of taxes has to be most expensive on real estate. Actually, who's paying for it?
The customer.
It's customer paying. I think sometime when all these customers come out, the government will realize, no, tax somewhere else and let them go scot-free.
Stop increasing the ready reckoner age everyone here.
That is something which I have never understood. What it is. I mean, on what pretext they do it and how they do it, and then the government says, income tax department says that under this clause, you cannot buy anything below the ready reckoner rate, or you have to change. You have to stop looking at it what it was historically looked at and look at it as an industry, which is the second largest employer after agriculture, the industry which is actually contributing to the GDP. There are more than 200 industries which are dependent on this industry, and it is providing one of the three basic necessities, shelter.
But you know, if we talk about the taxes, between service tax and stamp duty and registration, and then ready right now. It's three forms of central and state and local government that are making profits.
Yeah, then we have
you're asking for a change of heart, you know, from the top to the bottom.
See, where there's a will, there's a way. If they can have an affordable housing policy coming out, if we had the... Why don't we do residential SEZs? They're not going to, you know, take away a lot, but they're going to help in a lot of way. So if you can start doing it...
Residential rental REITs, for example, where you can create rental housing for people who don't...
Yeah, people to come and stay. Yeah. Still, people in India want to own. I mean, we have that phobia of owning property. But we should do such thing, at least for affordable housing, if you do the SEZs. See, SEZs has done good for IT. We are running SEZ and I know how it is done, how much employment it is generated. So if they do it for the residential areas, I think it will do a lot of good.
All right. What's your one word of advice for a customer or prospective home buyer who's watching right now?
Buy from a CREDAI member.
Buy from a CREDAI member. I'll rebut that and I'll give you a list of delays we've got from CREDAI members in Pune.
I understand.
So I don't think, I'm not going to take that at face value.
No,
from a CREDAI member is a good answer.
You look at the reputation of the developer.
Right.
You see that the plans are sanctioned and everything is placed. You see what deliverables have been done. You know, look at the past record and go ahead.
So buy from a reputed developer then.
Yeah.
All right. Mr. Magar, I wish you very, very good luck with your new project and all the projects to come. Thank you so much for spending time with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
You can watch live TV on our website, mbnow.in. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/magicbricksnow. And don't forget to click the like button. You can also follow us on Twitter at Magic Bricks Now. To stay updated with all our programming, hit the subscribe button on our YouTube channel by logging on to youtube.com/magicbricksnow.